For sure, right? For sure. I'm doing well. How are you, Jocks?
I'm just fine. Barcelona, it's not too cold right now. You know, it's not like the States. I know you guys have a huge storm.
Well, actually, we only had about 2 inches of snow here last night. So
Oh, shit.
we missed it. We got lucky. We missed it. And we've actually had very little snow this winter here, which is unusual for us. So it's been good winter for us.
But the snow is in California right now.
Yeah, figure that, right? I
Yeah.
know. My daughter lives in Los Angeles, and she couldn't believe it when it was snowing there the other day.
Yes, my friends also told me, hey, we have snow here. So
Yeah.
anyway, let me do a quick introduction for everybody else on the call. So I'm Jacques Barreau, the dean of the Big Academy for Transperfect. And we already did a few live events from the Academy. So many people can know me now. And we have today our guest is Kerry McGuire. And Kerry was graduated from the Big Academy in 2021. And did a very nice project for us last year in New York City, and we'll talk about that. So, Kerry, just let me ask you: do you have a lot of jobs now coming as a voice
Yeah,
actor?
I've been working pretty steady. I actually do a lot of UGC, user generated content, for a lot of different brands. So actually I get to do video myself in a commercial. I also do the voiceovers on the commercials if they're needed. Sometimes I act right on the commercial. So yeah, I've been doing a lot of that in the last year. But that job that I had in New York City last year, that was the most amazing thing I've ever done, though.
Well, we are going to talk about that because I think this will interest a lot of people, and also it was such a long project that it will be interesting for everybody to know and to see how you reacted as a human being and as an actor, you know.
Yeah,
So
absolutely.
let me relocate the project. So this was last year. And we had a TTS project to do. It was a German to English little documentary. And Kerry was nice enough to do the to volunteer for the I mean, we paid you. You didn't volunteer,
You paid me
but
very nicely. Thank you.
good, good. You volunteered to do that because it was a tough project. So what is TTS? TTS is what we call text to speech. So the concept is that right now people don't know that, but we have TTS all around us. You know, when you take your car and you put a destination on your navigator, when the voice is telling you, make a right on Main Street, turn left on the second street. So this is not a human voice talking. It's a voice generator or voice synthesizer, if you want, that has been fed by human voices. So we teach the machine how to speak, and after that, the user can type a text. So that's why we call that text to speech. So the user, the client, can type a text, and the machine is going to generate the audio of this text. So that's to explain the project. And I know it's a little bit controversial these days because, you know, we don't want the machine to take over because we are humans, so we have to be careful about that.
Sure.
But this is a very narrow application. You know, we use that in something very flat, e-learnings, direction for the car, instruction from your TV. You know, sometimes you have a spoken spoken instructions. So these are the main applications for the TTS, time to speech. So in order to teach the machine with your voice, you had to record, and now I'm going to let you talk because I talk enough. we are going to let you explain what was the length of the project and how you did that, where you did that, and how the engineer coached you, et cetera, et cetera.
Yes. Well, first of all, I have to say the project was in New York City, and I always wanted to say that I performed on Broadway. And the studio was on Broadway, so I can get up and say, you know, the neon lights are bright on Broadway. And it was fantastic. So I finally can say I performed on Broadway. So, yeah, thank you. I am too. But anyway, I live about 90 miles out of New York City, so it was pretty easy for me to get into the city. I just actually caught a bus right here. Not far from my neighborhood, and took me directly into the Port Authority at 42nd Street. So I just walked from 42nd Street down to 35th. I think it's 35th and Broadway where the studio was. So I walked down there. The project was slated for four days. So I wasn't sure what to expect because I'd never done anything quite like that before. So I got to the studio. And Dave Salierno was the audio engineer, and he did a great job. He was really nice, a nice young man. Appreciated all of his help. So when I got to the studio, we went up to the fifth floor, and I got in there, and they had a very nice setup with where he was stationed with his computer and his audio equipment. And then the booth that I went into, it wasn't real big, but it doesn't need to be big. You only need to just get in there. And it was closed off. Now I did find that working in a studio like that, boy, you are really tuned to every little pop, click, or when you're recording at home here, you still have existential noise around you.
Yes, because they're using the Neumann microphones.
Yeah.
So Neumann microphone is the best microphone you can get right now. It's
beautiful.
You have a big headphone on your head and here. Fly.
Yeah, I know. One time there you go. There's the doorbell. So, I could even hear my jaw pop one time. It was like, it was really crazy. But anyway, getting back to the story. So I got there. It was 300 pages of dialogue. Now, it wasn't just like paragraphs. It was mainly a lot of different sentences. I can't remember exactly how many lines it was, but it was in the thousands. Of lines. And so it was just basically getting in there, looking at that, making sure that I was set up at the proper distance from the microphone. And Dave checked our levels, make sure everything was good. And then so we proceeded to go line by line. And so it was basically a cold reading. So I didn't have time to sit there and really take too long to digest what you were actually reading. I'm sorry about that doorbell.
Or is it add a little bit spice to the...
I know.
It means...
But anyway, long story short, so I did these lines. There were some lines that were similar. You know, I read almost the same exact lines at a different time, not at the same time. Maybe on day one, I read this one line, and day three, I saw the same line and knew that it was the same thing. But I guess that was just to check how you sound at different times saying the same line. But anyway, so we went down line by line. Now, since there were so many lines, we would work for about, 45 minutes doing line by line. And then we would take maybe 10, 15 minute break. Just because you needed a break, you just couldn't keep doing lines. So, I had water with me in the booth, and Dave would check to make sure we'd go down so many lines, and then Dave would check. Make sure they all sounded good. And once in a while, we would run across a word. I would run across a word I wasn't even exactly sure how to pronounce. So right. I'd ask Dave, and Dave would, sometimes he wasn't sure, but he was able to, on the computer, he was able to look it up and get us the correct pronunciation of the word.
And little parentheses to explain that, in fact, these lines are created
I'm sorry, can I have your key?
By human being, And the computer, the machine, is choosing the best line for the generation. So if you want, and that's why sometimes in this kind of project, you can read some that don't make a lot of sense to you, because it's not literature, it's not poetry, it's just an accumulation of words, so the machine can understand what you mean, etc. So, and over just a little parenthesis, the studio where you went is part of the Transperfect building.
Right, yes.
So we have over 2,000 people, or maybe three, I don't remember how many.
York, it's a pretty big place, yeah.
It's the biggest office in the whole world, because it's an American company. And the studio is in one of the building. And I'm just saying hello to Molly, our friend Molly, who was in your seat last time when we did the live event. Hi, Molly.
Hi, Molly.
A great voiceover, and she was also doing the academy, and she does a lot of project now, and we are very happy for her.
Yeah.
So so tell me. What did you find? Did you find the recording difficult? Because, you know, after a while, after 45 minutes, your voice starts to be. You don't force on your voice, because it's not. You don't do crazy things, but you know, it's a steady flow. So, yeah. How many times 45 minutes did you do, and how were you at the end of the day?
Well, we worked. I usually we start around noontime, and we would go to 4:30, quarter to five, in that area there. So yeah, there probably were at least four sessions in one day, you know, going through so many lines. Did find you could tell by the end of the day, Dave could start hearing it, and I could start hearing it. Your voice started to get a little tired, and things that you know, it's time to wrap it up, because you can't overstress your voice, you know. And you want to try to keep it consistent throughout everything that you're doing. And that was the amazing thing, because every time we would get back in the booth after stepping out, we'd have to make sure that, you know, I'd have to make sure. And I sort of looked at the microphone, so I had a good idea how far away I was every time from that mic. And so we had to make sure we were always at the same position and keep it that way for that entire 45 minutes. So that was challenging.
Of course.
But, I mean, I thoroughly enjoyed it. I thought it was so cool to do something.
And probably David put marks on the floor for you to check.
Yes, yes, yes. Well, we actually had a stool. There was a stool there too. So
okay.
It was up to me, but it worked out. It worked out great. And it was fun. And like I say, working with Dave was good. We were constant, once in a while, we would laugh at some of the lines. Some of the lines seemed funny, you know, but I just realized that. But the other thing too was that there were certain lines that they wanted specific emphasis on once in a while. They had them underlined, and they wanted a little bit more emphasis under parts of the line that they had, I guess, just to give a different flavor of your voice, to show that you could, you know, rise or fall with different kinds of expressions and things like that. So, yeah, from that standpoint. So we worked. It was scheduled for 4 days, but when we got towards the end, we realized we were going to need a little bit more time. So we scheduled, and I went back, I think, another day and a half to finish up.
How many days did you do total?
I went into the city six days. The last day we didn't work the full, we didn't need the full 4.5 hours on the last. I think we finished that up in 2 hours that last.
And for our friends online, just to explain that, to do a project like that, for the machine to be able to understand the language, your voice, etc., we need between 7 to 10 hours of content, including the pauses, etc. So 7 hours of pure content, that's a lot of content.
Yeah, it was a lot. It definitely was a lot of content. And I, like I say, I don't know who wrote wrote the script or the lines, but I did find it was funny. There were a lot of references to President Kennedy in it, which I thought was interesting, but I'm not sure why that was. But it was sort of interesting. Yeah.
So besides this project, what else do you do now? Did you get some other jobs because of that? Was it good for you?
Oh, absolutely. It's excellent. I've done a couple other little voiceover projects. Nothing super. I mean, that's the biggest project that I've ever done. I did actually do a dubbing project for a French show that was dubbed into, they wanted dubbed into English. So I did a project.
Great.
I did a project on that. And that was a lot of fun. And that was with the Studio Next software.
We'll do a live event on Studio Next one of these days.
Yeah.
A lot of people are asking about that. I mean, just for our friends there online, Studio Next is our proprietary platform. And talking about proprietary, I see King 2 Editing is asking me, what is the name of the program that generated the lines you recorded? So it's a in-house program, and a lot of, you have a few software right now. I can give you some more details if you want. You can join me on the Dubbing Academy. It's a proprietary system that was developed by our engineers. Everything we do at Transperfect is proprietary, and same as Studio Next. Studio Next is a proprietary recording system, and so you were able to record at home, in fact.
Mm-hmm. Like I say, I find a big difference from recording at home and recording in the studio. Like I say, in the studio, it's much more refined. You're much more aware of every little noise that you hear. We're at home, you're not so aware until you actually listen back to it, and then you hear a little something in the background that you didn't hear when you were actually recording it. So it makes a difference. But what I did want to say about the dubbing project that I did was very interesting because of learning about, with the Dubbing Academy, learning about how that all works and with the lines coming across the screen and being prepared to say the lines at the proper time. So it was very interesting because I remember as a kid, those old Godzilla movies that were dubbed in from Japanese and English, sometimes people would be speaking, you see their lips moving 3 seconds after the actor was done.
It's not in frames, it's in seconds.
Yeah. So it's come a long way, I believe, but it's very interesting, you know.
This is the use of the Ritmo Band, and in when we'll do a live event on Studio Next, I will explain the concept of the Ritmo Band. And I'm glad you enjoyed it because it's, the Ritmo Band was the ancestor of the karaoke. And when you get the hang of it, it's so fast and you are in sync. So
yes.
That's beautiful. I'm just going to answer one question about what's the main target application of the voice generated by computer. Video games, other kind of application. I would say video games, not really, because right now all these voices generated by computer are kind of flat. It's good for like I said, direction machines, Siri, if you answer Siri on your phone, the Amazon system, e-learning, some documentaries, but as soon as you start having inflection, in game you have a lot of intonation. The games are something very, very intense. So yes. You cannot say, "Hey, be careful! A bomb is coming on you right now." So you cannot say that. So you say, "Hey, be careful!" So you have to act more. And the right now, the softwares and the few softwares that are on the market are not ready for that. So I hope I answered the questions. So I'm glad you like Studio Next. This is very interesting. We'll get something. So are you mainly in New York? And I mean, last question, and be honest, did the academy, did the course you did help you in some way?
Without a doubt. Sure. The things about voice plays, you know, you're up a register. You're a register here. You're registered down all the way down here and out here and things, you know. You always, hi, Jacques, how are you? Hi, Jacques, how are you? Nice to see you, Jacques. It's a great thing, Jacques. Jacques, is that you? You know, so learning about the different voice placements, yeah, and things like that, great, great help. And I did have, I've done some theater throughout the year, so I did have a little relation to, like, singing in a falsetto voice where you have to go way up here in the top of your head and things like that. So, but to learn the rest of voice placements made it really, like when I did the Bugs Bunny character in the class, one of the class projects, I found it was interesting, you know, Bugs Bunny, who doesn't love Bugs Bunny? And actually, you know, but I actually did it, and I thought I did it fairly good. I mean, I wasn't Mel Blanc by any stretch of the imagination, but I thought it sounded pretty good. So learning those things were definitely a great help, because you always use your voice in different ways for no matter what project you're doing. You may want a certain kind of voice for, you want something maybe down here a little bit more, or you want something just is more of a normal talking voice like we're talking back and forth. So learning those things was absolutely
That's monumental. Great. Yeah. Glad that it helped. And you're absolutely right. And you were saying earlier that it was a challenge for you during the recording in New York, that it was a challenge to keep the voice consistent.
Yes, and definitely.
This was your normal voice. So you can imagine when you do Bugs Bunny, you start like that, and little by little you go down to your normal voice.
Because what's up, Doc?
Exactly. And after that, you go back to your voice.
Right.
You like Marvin the Martian, you will talk like that. But if you don't pay attention, you are little by little, you are going to your voice. And
absolutely,
your voice, which is natural, it's human. When we change something, we always want to go back to the normal. So this is a very good point. So, and you can imagine for you, it was your normal voice and it was already difficult to keep it consistent.
Right. Oh, yeah, sure. Because sometimes you, depending on what kind of day are you even having, your voice can sound different. Or you get up in the morning, your voice is different when you wake up in the morning from what it sounds like maybe at noon or 1 o'clock.
And not the weather. The acoustic in the studio, even if it's in the same place with the same microphone, depending on the weather and the hygrometry degree, you can change the sound. That's why in the mixing stages, most of the time, I remember when I was at Warner, every day we were realigning the room and re-EQing the room to have a flat response. Because, right, you know, the weather is making huge variations.
Yeah, yeah.
So,
one interesting thing about that, one time I took a trip to Nashville where Elvis Presley actually recorded his songs. And when we went into the Studio B where he recorded his songs, they said, they had an X on the floor, and they called that the sweet spot of the room.
Correct.
So whenever Elvis sang, he went right to that spot there because that was a spot in the room that he sounded the best at. So it's interesting how that stuff all actually works.
Absolutely. And we have another question from Reknan. Despite the fact that I have not the chance to work on any TBT project as VO, I'm pleased for taking the Media Next course because the voice collocation and the rhythm band are unique in the course. That's a very good point. And we'll make a note to our team to make sure that we can find a project for you. So we'll do our best.
and the Studio Next has been evolving too from the time I've used it last year to the time that I've done some little work on it just recently.
Oh, yeah.
It's gotten better. At first, I had a couple few glitches one time. Those seem to all be ironed out now. So
You know, if you think about it, Pro Tools is probably 30 years now, 30, 35 years. Studio Next is 4 years.
Yeah. It's evolving. Yeah.
And we could do that because we have in-house developers. And all the developers are they are having a very good life in the south of France, you know, near Nice and Cannes. So we have a group of like 25 people. That's all we do. And they have developers. So for me, it's good because I can scream at them in French. So we understand perfectly each other.
Yes. We.
We. So, Kerry, do you have any questions for us?
No.
What do you want to see? What's your next gig? It's always interesting for us to know that the alumni are working. We are very happy about that.
Yeah. Oh no. My next gig right now, like I said, I've been making a lot of user generated content, which actually I'm doing copywriting, my own copywriting for too, which is sort of
interesting. This is great.
Yeah, I mean, because when you do a brand send wants you to do something for them, a lot of times they'll give you an outline, what they want, but they don't give you a script. They leave it up to you. So, which is cool because you can use your own creative juices for something like that. So I actually get to do it, sit down. Sometimes they want 15 seconds. Sometimes they want a 30 seconds. Sometimes they want a minute, depending. So, you know, you have to film a lot of stuff. And then, like anything, you have to edit it. And then prepare a voiceover. So a lot of times I will actually find myself writing my own voiceover script for the project. So that's really been a great help too, to be able to do something like that.
Of course. So great.
A lot of fun. Very good. I'd love to go back to New York. I'd love to go back to that studio in New York sometime and do another project.
We'll see what we can find for you.
I know it's a big world. It's a big world out there. I know that.
Do some shopping.
I took my wife up the one day while I was there. She went shopping around New York while I was in the studio. So she had a good time, spent some money.
New York is always great. Yeah. So look, it's 28 minutes. You know, this session go between 10 and 30 minutes. We don't want to be too long. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
A pleasure talking to you. And yeah. And we'll see you for the next project.
Well, if you're ever in New York, let me know when you're coming. I'll definitely come up and say hello.
I will let you know, absolutely. I will probably go this year. I have a lot of international trips to do, and New York, you know, it's. I was in Kenya 2 weeks ago. And
I saw that. That's amazing.
To Vietnam, and so I have a lot of trips coming. And the Big Academy is great for that. So thank you very much. Thank you, everybody, for joining the call. As you know, this is the first day of each month, correct? I'm checking with Claudia, our friend there. So every first day of the month, we'll have a live event, and we'll send the subject of the event in advance. So everybody, thank you so much. Kerry, thank you again.
Thank you, Jacques. Thank you.
Talk to you soon. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Take care.
Bye.